going to be playing his new song. This is All My Tears by his band Sons of Bitches. That is All My Tears from the band Sons of Bitches, fronted by my guest this afternoon, Linton Osborne. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Mark.
How are you?
I'm fine and dandy, thank you very much.
Nice to see you back in the studio here at Black Diamond FM.
Yes, it's been a couple of years, I think it has.
It has. You've been all diplomatic now.
Yeah. Diplomatic.
Now, to give you your full introduction to the listeners, you are Linton Osborne. You call yourself a singer of songs, but you're a singer, songwriter, and you have done various things over the years, including a recent stint of fronting the band Nazareth.
Yes, I fronted Nazareth in 2014. Mm-hmm. Yeah, some great memories from that and some great times, but... since moved on to something newer. So
we'll come back and we'll talk about Nazareth because we're just introducing it there. But the new band, Sons of Bitches, tells us about. Yeah, it's a live show. Tell us a wee bit about that.
Well, the new band is Manny Charlton, who was the original guitar player in Nazareth, and also he produced and recorded and wrote a lot of the songs, co-wrote with Dan. But all the sort of famous riffs you hear, it's Manny. And I speak to Manny yesterday, actually, and he says to all his fans, be patient, be patient, we'll be out there soon. Hopes to see you all soon. So, I said to Manny, do you want to do this? And he went, yeah, let's put it together. And he's obviously out in the States, so we can't actually physically get together, so it's all done, electronically. But, here Manny's going, right, can you send it to me? And it's got to be a minimum of 24-bit WAV file, and can you stick it in a Dropbox folder? And he's just so clued up about everything technical and whatever. And, he will be moving to Spain next month, so he's hoping to get a studio out there and get the band out there and do it properly. So it's all exciting stuff.
I think, you're giving the listener an insight into basically how the music business works nowadays.
Yeah.
And you can, I think, if I remember originally, Barbara Dixon, who's a fifer, she recorded with Elaine Page in two different studios and put together a song, and also Michael Jackson and Paul McCartney did the same, didn't they? Never actually were in the same studio at the same time.
Yeah, well, back in those days, they had pigeons that carried CDs backwards and forwards. Now we can just do it through a phone line, but...
And yes, there are loads of pigeon clubs in Fife.
Yes. My first album is called Pigeonhole. That's just a coincidence. But the trouble is, it's easier to make music and it's more available to people, but, nobody makes any money out of it anymore, because everybody downloads everything for free. So, even Metallica are losing money. So that's the state it's in. So you really can only make your money playing live now, which is a good thing because it sorts out the wheat from the chaff, see who can actually do it live. You can't beat touring. It's great. A lot of people. I don't want to blow anybody's cover on that, but they'll say to their partners, "Oh, I've got away on a 6-week tour, and you have no idea how hard work it is." Aye, it is hard work, but it's probably one of the best times of your life. It really is fantastic. You get to catch up on your sleep. For Facebook, your whatever it is. And then you get to play in front of thousands, hopefully thousands of people. It's a great life, but you do miss your friends and your family and whatever. But
I suppose in what you're saying there, Linton, about about how much money you can or cannot make nowadays, it's about the love of the music. That's how obviously you started, isn't it?
Yeah,
as a singer songwriter, and out on the circuit, I suppose as well.
Yeah, the thing is, a real musician does it because they love it anyway. They're not into it's not about the money. Obviously, back in the 70s and 80s, that was a nice side effect. That's what created proper rock stars. Just this vast sums of money. Led Zeppelin with their private jet and all that kind of thing. Real musicians just do it because they love it. And I know that Manny. For instance, he plays every day for fun, not because he has to or anything, because it's part of, it's just natural, it's breathing to him. I've got my daughter here, but she'll tell you, I'm forever singing about the house and whatever, usually she wakes me up, in the morning I can hear her singing about the house as well, so it's just one of these things, it's in your blood, there's nothing you can do about it, you just have to do it.
So, for the benefit of, again, I think we recorded the first interview we did with you.
Yeah.
Never did delete it. We recorded the first one. But take us way back to how it started for you. Where did your interest in music first come from?
It was really weird. Well, my father was, he was a folk singer in the 60s, actually, and he used to play guitar and stuff. And, I suppose I must have, sort of listened to that. But then, my parents split up when I was younger, and then my mum, she's not musical at all, although her siblings are. But my next door neighbour threw out a record player. She was a teenager at the time, so she threw out a record player when I was 8 years old. So I went through my mum's record collection, and I was 8 and put everything Blondie or whatever it was, and then I finally got to this one. It was a big pink album, a Camden record. Elvis sings hits from his movies, and I thought, I've heard of this Elvis guy, and they used to call him the King. So I put one that this record, and out came a song. It's from one of his movies. It's called The Long Legged Girl with a Short Dress On. It goes, all right, I've been thumb and rolls traveling. And if I had hairs on the back of my neck, you know, because I was so young, they would have been standing up. I was like, electricity going through my body. And then I just went on, and at this point, you know, as I grew older, all my friends are into Duran Duran, Spandau Ballet, Madness, and all that I was listening to was Elvis. And turns out I was right.
Well, I mean, obviously, you know, history just dictates exactly what you're saying.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, it started back then, and you moved on, and you did a bit of the Elvis when you were doing the clubs as well.
Yeah, I can't get rid of the Elvis thing. You know, I mean, as much as people say you can't do that like Elvis, and I'm thinking, you know what? I'm not going to fight it anymore. I could do the Elvis stuff because obviously our voices must have a similar sort of timbre or range. You know, and there's no. He was my major influence. You know, him and Plant. You know, Plant's major influence is Elvis. So, you know, before John Lennon said it, before Elvis, there was nothing. So, I'm not fighting it anymore. You know what I mean? If I want to wiggle my hips on stage, I will do so. You know what I mean? Or if I want to, you know, throw in a wee Elvis number, I will. But as I got older, I got into other bands. I was in a band years ago called The Plums. You know, Dunfermline's loudest band, and we did a lot of AC/DC and things like that. And the first band I was in at school was, I've mentioned this guy several times now, hi Colin Anderson, and he wrote the music for the first three Grand Theft Autos. So we're still in touch, and you know, so there's a lot of, I've always been in bands and always had a great time with musicians, and you know, but keeping a band together is like, it's like being married to four different people, you know, it's hard enough staying married to one person, you know, so...
Well, we're going to come back and we're going to talk about your Nazareth days.
Yeah, okay, that's
and we'll
fine.
Talk about that. And then we'll, in the third segment, we'll talk about what's happening now, and what's happening in the future, and where you're going. Yeah. But you're going to give us a wee tune.
Well, I'll try. You know, I mean, I'm actually playing tonight in Monty's. I believe there's still tickets available. That's Monty's in Dunfermline. I decided to put myself a wee acoustic gig together just so that I could improve my guitar playing, but luckily my friend Ross, or my guitar player Ross McHugh, and he's one of these polymath people. He's playing with Joel and Turner next week, so mm-hmm. I'm like his warm up, you know, this week. So he's coming down tonight to bail me out. So I'm just going to do a nice wee warm up song. It's actually on my first album, Pigeonhole, and it's an old Johnny Cash song called "I Still Miss Someone." Okay, here we go.
At my door, the leaves are falling.
If you have just tuned in, I am sitting here with Linton Osborne, singer of songs, singer-songwriter, and as we said at the top of the show, a former frontman for a little period with Nazareth. Now, you did the cabaret circuit, you did your own singer-songwriter stuff, you'd done various collaborations with other people, and then I presume it was a phone call or a conversation that came about regarding Nazareth. How did it all happen?
It was really weird, because I remember bumping into Dan McCafferty, because we've actually got the same, we got the same GP and whatever, and asked him how he was doing, and he was fine, you know, and whatever. But I had no idea at the time that he'd actually left the band. Not left the band, you know, had to retire because of his health. And I bumped into the road manager, Tam Sinclair, Hi, Tam. I've known Tam for a long time, and he says, you should go in for the job. And I'm going, what job? You know, Nazareth. I went, all right, okay. So I just sent an email and put my hat in the ring, and then I got the job. But, you know, as they said, it was only because I was the closest. You know what I mean? I was closest and by far the cheapest. So, yeah, but it was a great opportunity. We had some great times, and, you know, you can't, you know, you're playing in front of thousands and thousands of people. Mm-hmm. As I was saying earlier, you know, one of my favourite experiences was, you know, cutting a slice of honeycomb for my breakfast at the Moscow Marriott, you know. It was a fantastic time.
Was there a time at all where you sort of thought to yourself, you know, pinch me, is this kind of happening? You know, when you're standing in these sort of stadium scenarios in front of 10,000 people.
I don't know. I mean, maybe when some, you know, women in Canada were asking me to autograph their body parts, you know, I was thinking, this is a no bad job, this, you know. That was interesting, you know, and you know, you're turning up to hotels and you know, and there's Ferraris and that parked outside, and you're thinking, I'm staying here, this is fantastic, you know. But you know, most of them didn't have decent swimming pools, which is a, you know, a bit of a pain. But there was one in
Austria. I can just imagine, you know, swimming pools not up to standard.
It was just awful, you know. But there was one in Austria, it was like Surrey, and it had this infinity pool, you know, and it's just like, you know, it just goes over the edge, and you're constantly, so I'm out there swimming and just having a nice time, and the heat was unbearable. When I just popped my head up, and like some guy says to me, enjoyed the show last night. <You know? laughs> So, you know, I mean, it was a good experience, you know, and, you know, I got my gold membership for, you know, for KLM Airlines and whatever and that. So, you know, so a lot of touring is hanging about in probably Amsterdam Airport, you know. You get quite familiar with that. There's a lot of walking and involved around all these places, the airports and whatever. And it's not, you know, I mean, the ultimate high is being on the stage, and the rest of it, can be honest with you, is quite boring. You know, I can see why rock stars behave the way they, or they used to be able to, you know, before social media caught them out.
Well, I think it was Keith Richards that said, you know, I think he'd been doing 60 years or something. Aye. At that point, and somebody says, you know, how's it been over the last 60 years? He says, well, it's probably been 20 years of playing and 40 years of hanging about.
Aye, that's it. You know, it's a hanging about the backstage and whatever. And I mean, we've been as Nazareth, you tended to sort of just keep yourself to yourself and come together as, you know, as workmates, you know, just before the gig and whatever. And, you know, go through things and whatever, but I mean, it was some really good times, you know what I mean? And I met some great people, and there's something about the Nazareth fans, they're quite, I mean, they're right in when they say Nazareth should have been a lot bigger than they were, you know, there's no doubt about it, you know. Great musicianship, great songs, you know, but then again, you take four boys from Fife and you give them all these opportunities, they're still going to be Fifers at the end of the day, you know what I mean?
It's very true, eh? You can take the man out of Fife, but...
Yeah, you know.
Now, is it true, I think I read somewhere or somebody told me that there was a presentation of Dan's mic to you.
The golden mic, no, I mean, no, we actually got, I think Dan's mic, Dan used a corded mic, so they did buy... They did buy radio mics, so for me joining. So, no, I mean, but Dan and I have always gotten fine. You know, what I mean, I could phone him up and you know, to just have a wee conversation. I usually, if I'm sort of going over something, I'll just phone him up and say, you know what, Dan, you know, I've been listening to this, and it's not as easy as folk think it is it? You know.
Well, there's a question, because we were talking about that off air. How easy did you find it to fit into? I'm not going to diss this at all, but you know, it was effectively, you know, a Nazareth tribute to Dan, I suppose, really.
Well, you know, you had all that, you know, the fancy, it's a tribute, it's no Nazareth with Dan, but then, you know, the same argument is, you know, it wasn't the same with Daryl there, you know, Daryl, Pete, Manny and Dan was the original lineup, you know, so... but I mean, Pete started the band, you know, and you know, it's up to him what he wants to do with it, and you know, I think he does a great job, you know, and Kenny still give people what they want to hear and whatever. So, but as far as I'm concerned, you can't copy Dan McCafferty. You know what I mean? You know, and I remember Pete saying to me, "How many Dan McCafferty impersonators are in the world?" I'm thinking, well, no, there's none. You're right. You know what I mean? He's impossible to. He's got a unique voice, you know, and he's also a gentleman, you know. So. You know, I'm just glad that, you know, we're getting to do that. I'm getting to do this thing with Manny where, you know, one of his biggest things is he says, "Stop trying to sound like Dan McCaffrey, you know, I want you to sound like yourself." And I'm going, "I don't know what I sound like," you know. So, but he's bringing that out, and, you know, as a producer, he's fantastic. So,
so it's one for the CV, you know, you've done it, you've been there.
Yeah, yeah.
You've got the AC/DC t-shirt on.
Oh, I love AC/DC, you know what I mean? I love, you know, I mean, it's particularly Bon Scott's lyrics, you know, the tongue and cheekness of it all. Yeah, I remember discovering AC/DC as a teenager and thinking, wow, you know, it's just, but I mean, some people say they've only written the one song, and that might be true, but what a great song it is. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? If you fill out stadiums and people just chugging along for 90 minutes to the same song and being happy, you know, there's something about it when it just hits you right in the chest, that groove, and you're going, it's just,
Did you go and see them?
No, I didn't. I was actually working, you know. I was actually, because, as you know, I still have to, you know, make a living, you know. So, you know, last year I was playing in front of 10,000 people, and last night I was at Holiday Park, and there was kids running about, and people saying to me, "You know, play something we can, you know." You know the script, you know.
I know the feeling.
I don't want
well.
To shatter anybody's illusions of me, you know, being a millionaire rock star, but, you know, hopefully.
Still got to get back to the day job.
You've got to get back, you know, got to give it, you know.
Yeah. "Tu purio principessa nel tuo freddo stanza, guardi le stelle."
Just had to turn that way, way down. The power of the voice. Now, talking about the power of the voice, you're going to give us another wee tune.
Well, I'm going to try. This is one that we used to open with Naz, and, you know, I was always backstage, "Right, you've got to get this right, this is the opening number, get it right," you know, and there was just so much pressure on me that I would inevitably get it wrong. So I thought, well, I'm going to give it a wee bash and see if I can do this one, and you know, and we might have to edit this one out, you know what I mean? Is this going to,
we can do this.
You know, rewind it if I make a mistake.
Unfortunately, there is people listening live, though.
There's people listening live, you know. Sorry, listeners, you know. You might have to adjust the sensitivity of this microphone.
Facing the same old sights. looking for someone who will share our nights.
The fantastically powerful sound of Linton Osborne. We'll be back chatting up.
Our very own Mr. Entertainment, Mark Mulgrew on 107.8 Black Diamond FM.
Yes, that's me. And again, if you have just tuned in, I am sitting here with this afternoon's guest, Linton Osborne. And we've had a couple of live tunes. And yes, very powerful.
Oh, yeah, no, it's the years of practice, I suppose. You know what I mean? I started off with the Elvis stuff and then moved on to, I think it was The Who, and then somebody says to me, you sound like Robert Plant. So, of course, that was my next protocol, you know what I mean? But, you know, as you know, in this job, sometimes you've got to bring it a bit of Van Morrison.
I've had it said to me, Mark Mulgrew is a folk singer.
Folk singer?
Ah, well, people say, what the fuck is he singing? Yes, if you're playing this back, I did say folk. Now, you've got your project, Sons of Bitches, that you're doing, but what else are you up to nowadays?
Well, I mean, I think at the moment, it's just, until this band sort of hits the road, I'm just going to hopefully just do some acoustic gigs. And like I say, I'm playing with Ross McEwan tonight, and Ross has played with just about everybody you can think of. You know, people, when they come across from the States, they usually use Ross as a guitar player, so I was lucky enough to track him down, and his band is his younger brother, Ryan. He's at the drums, and then we've got a great bass player, Finlay Cable. So at the moment, I'm just keeping my head above water, just keep singing at the weekends and whatever, and let the... When we get out in there and play, I mean, people, you know, hear the band, hopefully that'll do enough talking, and they'll, you know... We've got a great management team, you know, great agency, getting us the gigs and whatever, and it seems to be, everybody seems to be happy and buzzing and raring to go, you know, so particularly Manny, you know what I mean, he's quite fired up, so...
I think it's half the battle, you know, if you're enjoying what you're doing, well, at a particular time.
There's a lot of hilarity goes on in our conversations, and it's just an ungeneral easiness of just being around each other, so I think that's the main thing. If you've got a unit that can actually travel together and work together and have a laugh together, then that's part of the magic. Because I think being a musician is one of the last, although it's not in a lot of cases, but musicians are the last free people on earth. Really, because everybody else is tied to, you know, this is when you get your holidays, this is what you do. But musicians do it because of love of it. And if you're lucky enough, you can make a living out of it. Mm. So, you know, people who see musicians on stage enjoying themselves, for instance, you know, you go to see AC/DC, you know, our favourite band, they're going to do what they want. Luckily, it's what we want as well. But when you see them enjoying themselves, the crowd enjoying themselves, it's a positive feedback situation, you know. So, you know, that's what people pay to go and see the last free, or like, they're almost like freedom warriors, just saying, middle finger up to the rest of society, we're doing this and we love it, and aren't we lucky? And you're going, yeah, you are lucky, but we want to be part of this, you know, just for this hour or hour and a half.
It is a two-way street. You know, regardless of what stage you're on, if you're performing to 10,000 people who are jumping about, or you're in a smaller venue and there's 20 people in, you know,
I mean, quite often I've played Nevada, I mean, all three of them have loved it, you know what I mean, on a Tuesday night, you know what I mean, they've had a great time, you know, you can dig out all the take the ribbon from your hairs and all that stuff. I mean, I love all the old music, I love Sinatra and Dean Martin, and you know, I love Chris Christopherson's writing.
You've been listening to my set list.
I've been all doing rap back stuff now, you know what I mean, you know, you make me feel so young, you know, that stuff.
There's another one.
We never get a chance to see each other working, because we're always working at the same time, you know.
I know, that's the thing.
But you don't do a whole lot of Rosie, though, do you? Cause that's
no, I don't do that. That's not particularly my style, I've got to say. Now, you've got a bit of a tour coming up as well.
We've definitely got the some dates confirmed for Germany. And Russia's in December. And, you know, you've got to get the visas and all that kind of stuff for Russia. And Russia's, it's just a wonderful country. I mean, but Moscow, I mean, you're talking five lanes of traffic, you know, just nose to tail. I mean, I would not like to drive in Russia, but I've got some Russian friends and that, so they're just great. They're just they're everywhere you go in the world, people are great.
I was going to say, you have your chauffeur, and you know.
Well, some people pick us up, yes, you know, because I am not, you know what I mean, I am not driving, you know, because say, right, boys, there's just go and hire a car. No, that's not going to happen. No, you do get picked up usually, all the time, actually. I think the worst one was we're in Romania, and it was like an 8-hour drive, and they're very strict about the rules across there. You've got to have brakes every so often, and you're only allowed to drive at such and such a speed. And Romania, the city centres are fine, but if you go out the town, it's like single, you're overtaken. Well, in our case, we were getting overtaken by horses and cars. You know what I mean? You know, because there's a lot of that still going on there. But I mean, it's a wonderful, it's a beautiful country. You know, I had a great time there. But you know, the roadwork network could be a bit faster. You know what I mean? So you're stuck in this minibus for 8 hours and that. You know, you can get a bit cranky.
I can imagine.
Yeah, but I know. I mean, I played all over. You know, in Canada was great. In the Czech Republic, oh God, you can get a meal for a fiver as long as you're not in Prague. You know, a meal and a bottle of wine for a fiver. It's just. You know, I've had some great times and some great experiences, but, you know, I'm really looking forward to the new project. And although I've heard Moscow's not particularly warm in December, you know, so,
But you're from Fife.
Aye, and my daughter's here. She's wanting, you want the hat. Hey, you're all wanting the hats. Your mother's wanting for Russian dolls for her pal. And everybody's always wanting something from Russia, you know. From Russia with love.
Yes. I knew you were going to say that. So if people want to find out more about Linton Osborne, LintonOsborne.com?
LintonOsborne.com, yeah. There's a link to the Sons of Bitches website as well. I mean, it's an ironic name, really, because, you know, I think the rest of the guys are really nice, you know. I'm not speaking for myself. But, you know, it's obviously a reference to, you know, a very famous song. And we will be playing, obviously, Manny. You know, we'll be going through his back catalogue when we're touring, so you'll hear a lot of hits that he's been involved with. And but we're really keen to work on new stuff and develop our own sound.
Yeah,
you know, and it is good because, like, even if Manny has done, you know, a cover of one of his own songs, he always
sounds a bit strange. Yeah, yeah, but that yeah. Is
he always updates it and makes it modern. So and his playing's just second to none. So. You know, I'm very fortunate. You know, I mean, it's been a bit of a roller coaster since I'm no longer in Nazareth. It's been a bit of a roller coaster, but it's everything's working out for the best. And their new singer, Carol, she's a fantastic vocalist. You know, so you know he seems to be fitting in really well with the boys. So you know, I wish them all the best. You know, but in some ways, I feel as if you know, it's worked out best for everybody.
Yeah.
You know, so
a learning experience, I suppose, as well.
It was a wonderful experience, and like I say, I've met a lot of people and just fans all over the world, people all over the world. I mean, what the governments do? Governments are to blame because the people I've met everywhere are absolutely fantastic. You know what I mean? Doesn't matter which country they're in or who's behind power. The people are fantastic everywhere.
Just avoid the politicians.
Yeah. That's
probably the best way.
That's what you've got to do.
You're going to give us a wee final tune? Or
I don't
have anything prepared.
I've not got anything prepared. Do you want? Do you want to join me for a wee song? No, I'm just asking my daughter. We sing in the house. Have you got any requests, Brown Eyed Girl or? Okay.
Anything that's less than 5 minutes long.
Less than 5 minutes long.
Yeah.
Summertime has come, and the trees are sweetly blooming. And the wild mountain thyme blows around the blooming heather. Will ye go, lassie, go? I will build my love a bower by yon cool crystal fountain.